please mute yourself also, and you can use for any question the chat, the Teams chat, and do not hesitate to use it during all the meetings if you have any questions. We'll try to answer to them as far as possible during the meeting. So maybe Pascal, while I start, if you can accept all the participants, that will be helpful. Thank you very much.
I do so, yes.
Thank you. Just before going to the topic of the day, meaning the presentation of sustainable construction by Saint-Gobain, I just wanted to remind you that the contest task for the Warsaw edition is at your disposal on the website of the Architecture Student Contest. Actually, I just show you how it looks like. Huh? You are able to find on the website the task description and a drone views of Warsaw and the contest plot, and a very useful format, which is a 360 view of the context plot, being a kind of immersive experience on all the streets around. You have also some resources that might be useful for your work, DWG files of the plot, which you can download in architecture software such as AutoCAD, and floor plans of the old factory. And what has been published last week, actually, is frequent asked questions, a file here. So we have received a few typical questions from you regarding the contest class. Do not hesitate to have a look on the website on this address, which I will copy paste actually in the chat. Just a few news also regarding the international jury members, which will assess and evaluate your project in Warsaw in next June. Here is the list of the validated members, but there may be also some extra one. But you see that we have some representative from the Warsaw City Hall, which is a great news actually, with an architect and the mayor representative for revitalization of the city. We have also some well-known members such as Catherine Sevillot, the president of the Cité de l'Architecture et du Patrimoine in Paris, who was already part of the jury for the Paris edition last June 2021. Christina Gamboa, also is the CEO of the World Green Building Council. So a well-known organization fostering a sustainable construction worldwide. And also some members of Saint-Gobain, of course, Pascal Veillard and Gabriel, who is also there, I think, among the participants. To remind you also the contest partners, the World Green Building Council, and as I've shared to you, the CEO of the World GBC will be part of the international jury. OneClick LCA, so the software aiming to evaluate the carbon footprint of the building, is also a partner, as well as the city of Warsaw and the French embassy in Poland also. Just to remind you that we have three training sessions, let's say, in order to share with you all the relevant tools and knowledge in order to prepare in the best way this Warsaw edition. First, so this is what we are doing today. It's 1 hour presenting to you sustainable construction by Saint-Gobain. What does it cover precisely with Pascal and I? This afternoon, you should also have received an invitation for a first session on how to use the OneClick LCA tool, because as you know, we've asked for this edition, and it's a new topic actually for the Architecture Student Contest, to have a life cycle analysis for the building and for your project. So there will be a first training this afternoon between 2 and 4 p.m. Paris time, with Mario Stikos, who is working in OneClick LCA, and a second training on next Wednesday, on the 8th, on the same slot, between 2 and 4 p.m. Paris time. And you'll be receiving also some Outlook invitation for fourth slots in January on the 10th and 11th to dig in more the comfort topics and what we are is requested also for the architecture student contest. So three main topics, and we start today with the presentation of what is sustainable construction for us at Saint-Gobain. And you'll see that it's pretty much what is underlying, let's say, the architecture student contest and what we expect also from you for the next Varso edition. Again, do not hesitate to use the chat for any question, and I leave the floor to Pascal. You're on mute. We don't hear you.
Thank you, Eric. Have you given me the hand?
No, you want it. You can.
I can take it.
You can take it. So you can ask it at least.
I asked for it. Okay. So.
Okay. Here you are.
Hello, everyone. So very happy to be with you today to share with you the vision of Saint-Gobain for sustainable construction. Hopefully it works. Yes. So sustainability in Saint-Gobain is quite a long journey that we started many years ago. As you can see there, actually it started in the early 2000 when we have built the very first foundations of what shall become later our sustainability policy. It all started with values and principles, as we believe that it is very much a matter of corporate culture. And what we did in that time is what we can rely on today to be a strong leader in sustainability. So beyond building our principles and values, we have also started to take some commitments in 2015 when we committed to the Sustainable Development Goals. An interesting aspect is also that by 2014 we published our first roadmap for sustainable construction. It was an internal roadmap, but it was already a major publication for us internally to shape our sustainable construction strategy. 2015 actually is a turn in our approach. As you know, it is the year of the Paris Agreement. So this is the year when the COP took place in Paris. And actually, it was a great opportunity for Saint-Gobain to start and take strong commitments. So we published in 2015 for COP our first major environmental objectives, which are the ones you can see there. So we started to commit on the recovery of production waste, on our CO2 emissions, and on our consumption of fresh water. Another major step in our sustainability journey was in 2019 in New York, when our
I don't know why, Pascal, but you're on mute. You have been muted. I don't know how, but
someone doesn't want me to. So 2019 was a major date for us when our CEO decided to commit to carbon neutrality no later than 2050. Since that date, actually, things have accelerated a lot for Saint-Gobain. And in 2020, last year, we published our purpose, making the world a better home. As a purpose for the group, it clearly puts sustainability at the very heart of how we define Saint-Gobain mission and vision. This year, a few weeks ago, we published our new strategy for 2021-2025, which is called Grow and Impact. And when communicating on this new strategy, we also communicated on our new vision, which is to be the worldwide leader in light and sustainable construction. So more than ever, sustainable construction is at the very, very heart of Saint-Gobain strategy. As I said, it's a key milestone in our journey for sustainability, and a journey that will have lots of consequences for us, both in terms of further commitments and in terms of operations and the new offer developments. When we say that we want to take a leadership position, what does that mean? Actually, we believe that as a group, we have two major levels of contribution to make the world a better home. First, through minimizing our footprint, so minimizing the impact of our supply chain and operations on the environment. And in the same time, by maximizing our impact, our positive impact, both on the planet and for the people. Just to give you an illustration of this dual approach regarding carbon. I hope it will... for the minimization of our footprint, as I said before, we have committed to net zero carbon by 2050. So this is clearly a major reduction of our carbon footprint. And in the same time, if we look at our impact, all the insulation solutions and glass solutions we sell over 1 year will reduce over their entire life cycle the carbon emissions of buildings. And these avoided emissions represent 40 times our carbon footprint. So we have by far a very positive carbon balance and a strong positive impact through the reduction of emissions with our solutions. If I move to a more global perspective, with this dual approach of minimizing our impact and maximizing our impact. So maximizing our impact will be at two levels, both in terms of sustainability and performance. And you will see on the later slide what it means. And about minimizing our footprint, I mentioned before the targets we set in 2015. We have published last year new targets for 2030, which are much more ambitious than the ones we published in 2015. It's also much more comprehensive. And typically for carbon, we have committed to reduce by one third our scope 1 and 2 emissions by 2030 compared to 2017. And by 16% our scope 3 emissions. These are targets which have been validated by the Science Based Target Initiative, so meaning there is even a third-party external validation on this target. And as you can see, we have also extended our commitments on circular economy. For instance, it's not just about reducing our production residues, it's also about replacing as much virgin raw materials in our products by alternatives. And it's also about developing more sustainable packaging, fully recyclable and with high recycled or renewable content. We have also committed to have all our activities, products covered with life cycle assessments by 2030. So major commitments to minimize our footprint. If we look more specifically at the building sector, clearly for us, it's a strong commitment to try and influence what happens with the building sector and to convince to build differently. As you will see on the next slide, the building sector is a major contributor to the environmental pollution, to carbon emissions, to the use of resources, and this is not sustainable. So it's definitely not possible to continue to build as we did. So we need to build differently, and this is what Saint-Gobain is promoting, and this is what we are promoting in particular through this approach. So it's not embracing all the topics, but we believe that this is the minimum to be addressed if we want to change the building sector and to drive it towards much better practices. So we have an approach that says that buildings over their entire life cycle should both enhance people's health and well-being. So sustainability is not just about environmental aspects, it's also about enhancing people's health and well-being, and in the same time, reducing the impacts on the planet. But in parallel to those two levels of considerations, we need also to secure that it will be made in good economic conditions. So it's important also to create economic value and to deliver quality. So this is the approach that we have decided to take in Saint-Gobain to promote, explain what sustainable construction should be, and also the approach that is behind the development of our offer towards the market. If we look more specifically into the sustainability pillar, there we see that we have four main priorities, which are energy and carbon, resources and circularity, health and safety on the job sites, and health and well-being for the building's occupants. And we have defined 12 drivers behind those four priorities, which are for us key drivers to design, build, or renovate more sustainable buildings. And this is what we are going, together with Eric, to explain further in the next part of the presentation. Just to before we move to a focus on the different aspects, to support this approach, which is an all-building approach. So as you can see, it's quite a comprehensive approach. We have developed this list of indicators. So we believe that to describe a building and its sustainable performance, we can rely on a limited set of indicators. So this is a proposal to qualify buildings and to define key indicators to feature the sustainability level of a building, maybe something that you can incorporate in your project to describe and explain how sustainable you have designed your project. As you can see, we have for each driver one key indicator, and this is covering the four pillars and all dimensions. So certainly something that deserves some attention on your part.
Thank you very much, Pascal. So as Pascal said, we are going now to, there is an echo. We are going now to go through those five pillars. You've seen energy and carbon, resources and circularity, health and safety on the job sites, health and well-being of the occupants. So the idea is to go through all those pillars and share with you some details of our vision at Saint-Gobain of sustainable construction, which is underlying what we expect also for the architecture student contest. Starting with energy and carbon, as Pascal said, and you might know also that buildings have a key role to play in decarbonization because they stand for a big part, around 40% of greenhouse gas emissions worldwide. So building sector is part of the problem, but is also part of the solution because we know which solutions to implement in order to have a positive impact on our footprint. And the challenge is to reduce the carbon emission over the whole life cycle of the building. There is what we call the embodied carbon of the building, mainly materials used over the whole life cycle. And there is also, as you know, the operational carbon, meaning the carbon for the use of the buildings, mainly heating and cooling. So we are going to go through these two drivers, defining what is a better building in terms of energy and carbon. It's of course a building having reduced operational carbon and in the same time reduced embodied carbon emissions. So if we start with the operational carbon at Saint-Gobain, and maybe you've seen that already through the task descriptions for the Varso edition, huh? We promote a fabric-first approach, meaning that the building should be first energy efficient through a highly performing envelope. What does it mean precisely? It means that the need for heating, cooling, lighting should be kept to the absolute minimum, and that the remaining energy need should be supplied with renewable and decarbonized energy sources. And this principle, it applies to renovation, to reduce the energy consumption of existing buildings, but also for the design of new buildings that should have energy needs close to zero. When we say energy need, for your information, it's the and we ask to calculate it for the contest task. It's the actual energy unit for a provided service before the systems and equipment energy losses. So what does it mean at building level? What does it mean for a building, this energy efficient envelope first? It means, of course, thermal insulations, roof, walls, floors, to reduce heat losses and summer heat gains. It means also, of course, glazing to let sun in and block it out. Can be also smart membranes to improve air tightness and moisture management. It can be smart technologies, for instance, to monitor and control the energy consumption. And it can be performing heating and cooling equipment. So this is basically our vision, energy efficiency first, thanks to a performance envelope. And the second main driver, as already said, it's embodied carbon to reduce the carbon footprint of the operation of the materials themselves. So embodied carbon, again, as opposed to operational carbon, refers to a quantity of CO2 equivalent embedded in the materials used to construct and maintain the building throughout its lifespan. So basically, it's what material extraction, the manufacturing of the material, but also the construction, demolition, and end of life. Here you have a few graphs that are important to have in mind. Maybe you know already this order of magnitude, but about half of the carbon emission over the life cycle comes from the materials themselves. And the other half comes from the operational carbon, in average, of course, because it can vary a lot depending on your country, your energy mix, and so on. But that's the order of magnitude to have in mind. And the four most important construction materials in terms of embodied carbon are, of course, cement, steel, aluminium, plastics. But in the remaining material categories, you'll find insulation, the doors, the windows, the glass product, gypsum, mortar, of course, which have also an importance. So what does it mean to have a reduced embodied carbon emission at building level? It means, of course, having low carbon materials and product, decarbonized transport and manufacturing process, high level of recycled content, or use of alternative low carbon raw materials. And it means also lightweight construction. And we are going to share with you a few examples of Saint-Gobain solutions illustrating these topics. We'll start, for instance, with biosource products. You know that some materials are able to capture and store atmospheric carbon dioxide. It is a process called carbon sequestration. For example, wood products sequesters the so-called biogenic carbon during the growth of the tree. And at the end of the building life, this storage is either released or continues in the next product systems. But us at Saint-Gobain, we have, for instance, some ETIC systems with cork insulation. We have also some wood fiber insulations, mainly in France. But it's just for your information to know that we are also more and more on those markets, which can have an impact on biogenic carbon and finally on the embodied carbon of the building. We have also an ambitious actor on lightweight systems. Here you have a few examples coming from a few different countries in gypsum business, for instance. And you might know that, for instance, for the internal partition wall, using drywall can present a lot of benefits in terms of embodied carbon, especially if you compare it to traditional wall systems, such as cement plastered with bricks. And it can have a very big impact, around 60% of reduction in terms of global warming potential of the system. Another example at Saint-Gobain on how we contribute also to reduce embodied carbon is an external facade. We have some example of lightweight system. Here is an example of the French F4 facade system. And you can see that with lighter cladding, we're able to replace concrete in the facades and in that way having a reduced carbon footprint. F4 here you see compared to ETIC on concrete wall or even internal system of insulation on the concrete wall, it is very interesting and powerful in terms of global warming potential. So that our vision again on carbon is first the envelope and energy efficiency and having impact on the embodied carbon thanks to lightweight construction. To prove that, we believe strongly in product transparency. And I'm sure that you've studied this in your universities. All this documentation now manufacturers are able to share in order to prove their impact on the whole life cycle of the materials. This is the so-called life cycle analysis at product level. And in the construction market, those proofs are displayed in the format of what we call Environmental Product Declaration, EPD. And Saint-Gobain is one of the leaders in this topic because we are able to provide to you more than 1,500 verified environmental product declaration on all our offer. Insulation, of course, but also gypsum product, mortar, glass, ceilings also with our brands such as Ecofond. So, as I said, they are third-party verified. And within this EPD, you'll be able to find all the needed information of the impact of our product on carbon, on what we call the global warming potential, but not only, on many other topics. And we've seen that it's an international offer in terms of product transparency in more than 30 countries. So that was, in a nutshell, our vision on this first pillar, which is carbon and energy. And I hope it will be helpful for you also in order to work on your project. The second main topic is resources and circularity. So Pascal, I let you comment this part. And again, do not hesitate to ask for questions in the chat. Huh?
So like for energy and carbon that has been just presented by Eric, I will introduce the topic of resources and circularity. And I guess this is already something you know, the building sector is by far the largest sector in terms of consumption of raw materials and generation of solid waste, with 40 to 50% of the total consumption of raw materials. There is no other sector that do consume so many natural resources. So this means that for the built environment, we have two main challenges. The first one is to use less virgin non-renewable resources. So we need to find ways to replace scarce resources, resources that start to be threatened by depletion. And the second challenge we have is to reduce the waste to landfill to zero. Today, there are much too many waste landfills, not recovered, not reused, and this is a huge waste of resources. And actually, those two challenges can be combined into one to be more circular and less resource intensive. So like for the energy topic, I will go through the four drivers that we have identified as top priorities for the resources and circularity topics. So the need to use less non-renewable resources, to reduce the consumption of fresh water, to also increase the lifetime and the use rate of buildings, and finally, to reduce the amount of non-valorized construction and demolition waste. So going through each of those four drivers, so it's quite obvious, this is probably the best known driver, so to go for reused materials or to renewable materials or for recycled content in the building. So this is clearly valid for the products and the materials themselves, but this is also important for the packaging. Very often when we discuss plastic packaging, for instance, we think of the food sector, of the cosmetic sector. Just keep in mind that just behind food and cosmetics, the construction sector is the third one for the consumption and the use of plastic packaging. We need also, besides looking only at materials, products, we need also to embrace a broader approach, looking at systems and solutions. So there are ways of combining products and systems in a more efficient way regarding resources. And again, this is very much about going for lightweight constructions. And finally, and it's very important for you as designers, you need to reduce as much as possible the bill of materials. So we need to think in terms of lean design, not putting materials in excess, but really using what is necessary and not more. The second driver is about fresh water consumption, with one single indicator, which is the consumption of water per year, per square meter, and per occupants. And there, it's mainly about using building solutions that require less water, less water at production stage, but also less water to be installed on the job site. In that sense, moving towards dry construction techniques is clearly a way of optimizing the use of water. Last but not least, over its entire life cycle, besides reducing the consumption, it's also very important to think in terms of also of recycling of grey water and possibly collect of rainwater, in particular to take care of the green surfaces on the building or around the building. The third driver, which is not necessarily the best well-known, is about the lifetime and the occupation rate of the building. We need to make sure that buildings will last as long as possible. There is nothing worse than demolishing a building because it's not fit for use to build a new one that will be more adapted. So we need to think, and it starts at design stage, about designing and building constructions that will be easily adaptable and flexible over time. It shall be, by design, easy to adapt the building to a change of use, and also to make it flexible to adapt to variable use of the building over a short period of time. Typically, it should be easy to switch from a residential to an office building and vice versa, like it should be easy to have a building that during the day is maybe dedicated to one type of use and in the evening switches to a different one. Resilience is also a very important aspect. So it's in relation to climate change in particular. So we need to make sure that what we design and build today will still be fit for use in a different climatic context in 20, 30, 50 years from now. So this can be already taken into account in the design of the buildings today. To make the building lasting long, clearly it's about using materials and solutions which are durable. And last but not least, not only durable, but also easily repairable, easy to maintain, to make their lifetime as long as possible. The last driver, reducing the amount of non-valorized waste. So first, it also starts on the job site. So we shall strive to have zero waste job sites. Any solution that allows for no waste on the job site is clearly to be favored. We need also to think in terms of deconstruction and not anymore in terms of demolition. So this again is a design challenge. From the design, we need to anticipate how the building in 50, 60 or 100 years will be deconstructed, or if at some time for renovation there is a part that needs to be changed, it should be easily disassembled and easily deconstructed. It's also about traceability. If we want to reuse later what has been put in a building, we need to keep trace of what has been implemented. So everything you will put in your design needs to be recorded, needs to be kept over time, amended with any work which will occur during the lifetime of the building. If we want to reuse easily materials in the future, if you want to recycle easily, we need to secure that that there will be no hazardous substance in the product. It's clearly a way to facilitate later recycling. Not to say that materials with hazardous substances are not recyclable. There are always solutions, but this might be more expensive solutions. And again, it's also a challenge in terms of traceability, keeping track of all the substances which are in a product installed in a building is also a way later to identify whether or not there are some hazardous substances in the products. Packaging, I mentioned already, so making sure they are easily recyclable and reusable. And it's also important that there will be recovery solutions. So we as manufacturers have a duty to offer recovery solutions if reuse of the products or recycling of the different products. So you can see that resources and circularity embraces lots of different dimensions. So it's not an easy topic, but it's clearly at the same level as the CO2 and energy. A key challenge that we have in front of us. And I mentioned many times that it's a design issue. If things are not properly anticipated at design stage, it will not be possible to handle in a circular way later on. What does that mean in terms of solutions? So, taking again this dual approach of reducing our footprint and maximizing our impact. So in Saint-Gobain, we have committed to replace, and it's one of our 2030 objectives, so to replace as much as possible virgin raw materials by alternatives, alternatives such as recycled materials, recycled glass in glass wool or in flat glass, byproducts as well. So for instance, using slag wool coming from the steel industry in mortars or in stone wool. We have ambitious plans to reduce our production waste. So we are striving towards zero waste in our factories. And I've put also there an example of sustainable packaging that we developed for our mortars in Brazil, but we have similar examples in many countries and in other businesses, switching to from plastic bags to paper bags, fully recyclable. And we have even put in place a take back service where all the used bags are sent back to the producers to be recycled and reused into the production of new paper bags. In parallel, we extend the time of use of our products. So we strive to have long-lasting products to make them reusable and recyclable, and switching to how we maximize our impact. So first, we have included into our specifications to develop new systems that they shall be easily dismantlable at their end of life. Here you have two examples, the F4 facade that Eric mentioned before, which is a low carbon facade. It has also the benefit of being easily dismantlable. Every part can be separated on the job site, on the deconstruction site, and can be recycled into new products. And on the left side, you have a premiere. It is in Germany. It is an ethics system, so mortars on insulation, where all components are easy to separate. Usually, ethics systems are hard to recycle because it's almost impossible to separate the mortar from the insulation. Here, we have developed a system that allows for such a recycling. Eric mentioned before that lightweight systems are good in terms of carbon, but they are also good in terms of reduced use of resources. If again taking the same example of the partition wall in Brazil compared to a brick wall with plaster, you can see that we have a significant reduction in the use of non-renewable resources, as well as in the use of water over the entire life cycle. So lightweight products and systems, again, are also highly profitable in terms of circularity and resource consumption. In parallel, we develop waste management services. So we have started already in many countries to introduce such services through our distribution activities. And we have started already in 2008 for gypsum to recycle plasterboards. Today, we have recycling services for plasterboards in more than 12 countries. We have started also to develop such services for glass wool products, mineral wool products, and for flat glass products. And last but not least, one way to reduce the generation of waste on the job site is to deliver the right quantities to the job site. So here you have two examples, one in France on the left and one in Sweden on the right, when we have a make-to-order service. Only the right quantity at the right dimension is delivered to the job site. It's even delivered exactly when it is needed for installation. In Sweden, this is a pilot project with one major contractor, and it's all connected to the BIM system and the digital model of the building. So everything is almost automatized. Further ways to reduce the use of resources and to maximize our impact through prefabrication. So we have ourselves in Saint-Gobain some activities in prefab, and we are also a major provider of products and solutions for prefab manufacturers. We have also started to develop 3D printing solutions, for instance, in the Netherlands. This is through our mortar activity, we have even built the first 3D house in the Netherlands with a 3D printer, and it proves to work already. And this is clearly a way to consume the exact quantity of resources without wasting anything on the job site. And last but not least, mechanization is also a good way of using the right quantities of materials without waste. Typically, what we do through blowing wool machines to insulate lofts, or through the use of tools to spray the mortars on the facade, again using exactly the right quantities without any waste. A last comment: I mentioned resilience as a key topic. It's a major topic to be looked at design stage to protect the building from heat, from floods, from bad weather. Here you have a few examples of solutions that exist, for which Saint-Gobain has developed already or will develop solutions. And again, something important to take into account. So we design shall take consideration for what will be the building environment in 20, 30, 50 years from now, just to make sure that this building will be still livable and will resist to any change in this environment. I give back the floor to Eric.
Thank you, Pascal. So yes, so that was a few details regarding resources and circularity. And now we suggest to go through the last pillars, meaning health and safety on the job site and health and well-being for the occupants of the building. Before concluding. So regarding health and well-being, buildings have a key role to play for health and safety, and also for health and well-being of the occupants. A few key figures to have in mind before going in more details. The first is on the right of the slide for the occupants. You know that we spend around 80% of our time indoors, and it's even more in COVID context. So delivering healthy indoor environment is very key, and improve the occupants' comfort is a key topic, and we are going to show with you a few more details. And also regarding the job sites and the installers, the workers on the job sites, we need, the big challenge is to reduce health risk for the builders, because we see respiratory diseases or musculoskeletal diseases for both during construction and deconstruction phases. So we need to, those two topics of health and safety and health and well-being, you find here the drivers on which we need to improve altogether, manufacturers, designers, architects, in order to build better buildings in terms of health and well-being. So we'll go first through the health and safety on the job site with these two drivers. How do we reduce first the builders' exposures to hazardous substances? You know that it's a key topic. For instance, in 2015, 17% of the workers in the European Union reported being exposed to chemical products or substances for at least a quarter of their working time. So a lot is at stake on this topic. And what does it mean precisely for us as manufacturer? It means delivering product with no or low level of hazardous substances on the job site, having no or limited release of VOC, volatile volatile organic compounds or hazardous substances during installation and deconstruction phases, and having also non-hazardous waste. And it means also improving the working condition of the builders themselves. And it's at the very heart of the Saint-Gobain approach, because the builders are also our customers. And safe job sites are about reduced occupational risk for the workers during all the construction, renovation, or deconstruction of the buildings. Thanks also to products with limited substance of very high concern, but also thanks to a non-irritant or low dust product. And I'll share with you a few examples on this topic of precisely low dust product in our mortar activity, for instance, external mortars, for ATX, for instance, but also for tile adhesive, for instance, where we have a complete offer on this topic. But it can be also on a product easy to install or lightweight also. This is, for instance, the Gyproc Ergolite product, the lightweight technology, to ease the installation of the product and in that way the comfort of the installer. And now the occupants, Pascal, of the building.
Yes, so there we have, as explained before, four key drivers, which are indoor air quality, acoustic comfort, thermal comfort, and access to natural light and outside views. I guess these are already well-known topics for you. Still, I will go through each of them. So when it comes to indoor air quality, there you have two kinds of indicators. First, the concentration of CO2 in the indoor air, but also the concentration of VOC, volatile organic compounds, in the indoor air of the building. Four key aspects to look at. First, the ventilation strategy. So it's key, whatever the building, whatever the materials, the solutions, the way it is designed and built, you need to have a renewal of fresh air in your building in the good volumes. So ventilation, if natural or mechanical, has to be taken into account, and for that you need to have a proper strategy. Second, you need also to secure that your building is airtight and that you have a proper management for moisture. So airtightness is clearly also a way to improve your ventilation strategy. So any leak is disturbing the way the building is functioning. But it's if you have also some issues with airtightness, it has a link also to moisture. So that's why we have put both together. You need to have the right strategy to manage the air leaks and the moisture of your building. Third, obviously, you need to go for low emissive products and materials, low emissives in terms of VOCs. We mentioned before the low release of particles or substances, but it's also important that during the use stage, buildings, products will have very low levels of emissions. And in parallel, it is possible, and you will see later examples, so Saint-Gobain has developed products that not only are low emissive, but also able to capture the pollutants in the indoor air. So we have products able to reduce the quantities of, for instance, formaldehyde in the indoor air, so active products reducing indoor air pollution. Moving to acoustic comfort, so there the indicator is quite technical one, but I guess you know it also. And there you need to have a strategy at three levels. First, to protect occupants from external noise or from inside noise, typically noise coming from equipment such as for instance, the lift. You need also to have solutions to improve the levels of ambient noise. So when you are in your room, to make sure that the level of noise is well controlled. And finally, and it is in particular very important in buildings such as schools or educational buildings, you need to have a strategy to secure that you control the reverberation of noise and that you secure a good level of speech intelligibility. And for that, there are lots of different solutions available that will protect from noise, will also reduce reverberation and secure a high level of speech intelligibility. Thermal comfort, this is very much linked to what you will have done to reduce the energy consumption. So this is this goes quite hand in hand with the energy efficiency topic. This is also connected with ventilation. So having buildings with a performing envelope is clearly the best way to secure a good thermal comfort. This thermal comfort approach needs to be adapted to the site according to the orientation, to the neighborhood, and it needs also to be adapted to the climate condition on the site. As I said, it's part of the building envelope. A good thermal insulation not only delivers energy efficiency, but it delivers also good thermal comfort. To secure access to natural light, this can be measured in terms of daylight autonomy. So what is a part of the day you can use your building without using artificial light? There, clearly, it's about putting transparent glass surfacing, so to have as much light coming in as possible. It's also about taking care of how you design your interior spaces. You can have opaque partitions, but you can also go for transparent partitions that help light to circulate. And if you go for opaque partitions, then you can also make sure that you have the right products that will properly reflect the light and secure as much brightness as possible in the room. Clearly, when you open the view, when you let the light coming in, you also open the view to the external aspects, and this is also very important to be considered. And to conclude, what does that mean in terms of solutions for Saint-Gobain? So we have a wide range of acoustic solutions, typically our ceiling solutions to bring comfort, especially in spaces such as schools, offices, where speech intelligibility or reverberations are key topics. I mentioned before the active solutions. So this is called Activair. We have plasterboards, we have tissues for the walls that capture formaldehyde in the indoor air. We have solutions for air tightness and moisture management. So these are all the Vario membranes that we offer with their accessories. And we have a full range of high-performance glazing to let the light in, but without disturbing the thermal comfort, so not too hot in summer, just as needed. Beside that, we offer also services to measure the level of comfort inside buildings, make diagnosis, and possibly offer solutions to renovate for better comfort.
Okay, thank you very much, Pascal. So To conclude again, if you want to summarize, we've been through all those topics during this hour, meaning the 12 drivers for more sustainable building. We wanted to remind you that with the organization team, we stand at your disposal for further questions on our vision on sustainable construction, and also on the contest task in itself for next June. As you have understood, this framework we have shared to you, you have a field to play, which is the next Warsaw edition with this plot to renovate and with a mix of renovation and new build, in order to illustrate all the topics we have been going through. So we hope this presentation was clear to you. There are not much questions in the chat, so I hope it means it was transparent enough in terms of information. We can take a few minutes to answer to some of you if needed. Again, this meeting has been recorded and will be shared on our architecture student content website. So do not hesitate to share it to your colleagues, either teachers or students, afterwards also. Thank you very much for your attention then. We see again at 2 p.m. Paris time. For a first session of training with the one-click LCA tool, in order to assess the carbon footprint of the building in the contest task. Okay for you? Yes?
Yes.
Thank you very much, Dan.
Thanks a lot.
Take care and see you this afternoon for the ones who are joining.
Ciao.
Bye-bye.
Thank you very much. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye.